Welcome to School Talk. I'm Nadja Varney, your host. On education, there are books and periodicals, conferences are held, the newspapers publish articles, and the internet is just flowing with commentary. In fact, Congress is debating education law. We're often used to hearing from experts. Well, today, I think my guests represent real experts, true experts, who are really right in the trenches, both inside the school and out. I'm so happy to welcome the presidents of the Rhode Island PTA, Katherine Patenaude, and the Massachusetts PTA, Michelle Tremont, or Tremont. Am I saying that correctly?
That's fine.
Amazing. People have so much trouble with my name, you'd think I would really work harder on this show. But thank you so much for joining me.
That's a pleasure.
And before we get into the issues, I wonder if you could just very briefly tell me, how did you get into PTA? Michelle?
I went to my daughter's kindergarten orientation at her school. And in the middle of talking about the curriculum and what was expected of the children, the PTA president stood up and said, here are the opportunities at the school, and here are volunteer opportunities. And I signed up for three different committees and never looked back.
And you never looked back. And you had several children?
Just my first child in kindergarten. And now I have two in school.
Two in school, plus
yes.
Doing all of this. Well,
yes.
And I think I read about you that you teach yoga on the side. I don't know
yes.
where these mothers get all the energy, but you do it all. Thank you so much. And Katherine Patenaude, how did you get interested?
Well, actually, my daycare provider, when my child was, I only have one daughter, who's actually a sophomore at Providence College, but when she was just 2 or 3 years old, she made sure to tell me that the best thing I could possibly do was to get involved with the PTA at our local school, and that's the community that she absolutely positively loved, and that she had volunteered at our school and wanted to make sure that I would, without fail, start in kindergarten and not wait till first or second grade, that as soon as my child went to that school, I should get involved with the PTA. And I did.
And you haven't looked
back.
And
I haven't looked back either.
And I know you're working at Brown doing some very important things in biology with their science students and medical students and graduate students. So I don't know. It's just amazing to me. And they do say, when you need something done, get a busy person. So here you are. Now, I really want to know, what is PTA? Just for our listeners. People have some strange ideas about it. What is it? How has it changed in recent years? And maybe you could talk to, what are some of the hot topics right now? Michelle Tremont?
What is PTA?
Yes, that's the question.
The very, very short, from my perspective, and I think PTA is different for every person involved, but from my perspective, PTA is a parent-led, pretty for the most part, volunteer advocacy group. So it is a volunteer-run and led, member-driven group that is working on behalf of all children across the world. Because there are PTAs in every state, in addition to Washington, D.C., the Pacific, Europe, and the Virgin Islands.
Even it is primarily then an advocacy group.
Absolutely.
You're advocates for kids and their teachers and their schools, probably,
That's
I
right.
could say. Well, how has it changed, though? PTA's been around a long time. Any recent changes? Katherine?
I think we have become an organization that has to look at our future. And, you know, the new parent is a different parent than the parent of the PTA that my mother belonged to. And PTA, I think, has changed with that change in who our membership is. And one of those things is the opportunities for leadership have really changed. Years ago, typically a mother or a father would join the PTA and maybe not even become a leader until maybe their child was in sixth grade, for example, and become the secretary, the treasurer, the vice president, and all the way up till finally the president. Today, because we have so many leadership opportunities with parents that are out there working and have wonderful careers, they're quite capable of taking on the leadership role as president, and that's the first office they've ever held in the PTA. And so, you know, you really need to think about what you need to offer those parents. They want to go to a meeting and get work done. They're very driven, and they don't want to just hang around and socialize. And so they really do, in fact, want to get work done at a meeting. And so we've had to learn that the training that we offer is training they really want to go to and get something out of.
Which sounds very much like the school systems, too, changing the old professional development model to the new paradigm. But I did wonder about the hot topics. I read on your site that you have done a great deal with getting chemicals out of schools. I read some of that on the site. Is that one of the hot issues, or are there other things that are really driving PTA?
I think that that's our vice president of legislation. Right. She's very much into school health and safety, mm-hmm. so she does talk about getting the chemicals and the chemical cleaners and mm-hmm. the clean air, and mm-hmm. she goes on and on. That's, I would say more, though, that the hot topics in PTA, and you can certainly correct mm-hmm. me if you think disagree, are educational funding mm-hmm. and child wellness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, childhood obesity was something that we as a group decided to bring as a grassroots organization. We are grassroots. Mm-hmm. We want to hear from the membership and not from, per se, you know, the leaders at the national level. Mm-hmm. So we always try to see where our grassroots mm-hmm. initiatives come from, and really childhood obesity was one of the big ones that everybody's concerned with. And with our wellness policies that are being mandated, I know in Rhode Island, I can't speak for Massachusetts, but Rhode Island, all of our districts have to have wellness policies in place.
It's part of the federal law.
Mm-hmm. Again, so you have to deal with that, the federal, right. the state, the
exactly.
local expectations on you. Mm-hmm. And of course, equity and access to education, equal opportunity, mm-hmm. is still such a horrible, it's still in a pretty bad state across the country.
Exactly.
Yes. I don't know about particularly all of Rhode Island or Massachusetts, but you still have places where opportunity may not be equal. Does the PTA, because you said grassroots, do you mm-hmm. hear from those schools where there are many poor people, minorities, people who are working three jobs to keep alive? Do you get grassroots to them, information back and forth?
Yes. Traditionally, PTA has serviced middle-class communities. Mm-hmm. It has been an initiative of National PTA, and certainly our states are grasping mm-hmm. onto it to reach into the more urban, more diversified communities. Mm-hmm. National PTA has offered us training to help us get into the cities, mm-hmm. and there's a brand new initiative mm-hmm. where there's going to be people to come in and help us to get into those schools. Yes, it's mm-hmm. PTA's job, and it's our job to get into every community, every mm-hmm. child. Mm-hmm. Yes, we're hearing it's every school is struggling.
Across the country, in some urban settings, PTA is much stronger than you might find in Rhode Island or New England.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of our parent organizations are PTOs or PT others, we affectionately call them. They do have parent groups, but they're not PTA. And so we need to focus, because we have so many wonderful things to offer the urban communities, that I think we're really trying to look at the diversity piece and to offer programs that will work for urban
I think that
families.
Is a very worthy goal. You know, would you believe, and I believe the statistics would back it up, that schools are more segregated today mm-hmm. than 40-some
yes,
years
true.
Ago with Brown versus public education. Yeah. So a lot of it is related to other things like housing and jobs, but mm-hmm. the schools are still, you know, we're still there for every child.
Yes.
Speaking about goals and what you're trying to strive for, and I know we could do a whole show on each one of these topics, but in general, what would you say you're hearing from parents, the expectations of parents for their children? And I thought we'd go level by level. So let's start with early childhood, preschool, kindergarten. In general, what are parents expecting, and what is their role in that?
Early childhood. Parents expect to have access to early childhood.
Access.
Mm-hmm. I mean, there's no money. There's no money. Both parents are working. So to even have quality access to childcare so that they can go to school before kindergarten, have it work, frankly, if it's even available, that's what parents are expecting these days. Unfortunately,
unfortunately, all-day K, which would work wonders in any community, is not accessible for a lot of communities right now, and because we just don't have the money in our budgets. And the pre-K, pre-kinder programs for three-year-olds, for example, typically are only funded for a special needs child. So the IDEA mm-hmm. law that has, in fact, you know, given communities the responsibility to bring in those children that age, typically a child who doesn't qualify will not get that pre-kinder sort of programming that is so essential, so that when they're really ready for kindergarten mm-hmm. in first grade.
Isn't it amazing? And, you know, I did say, what's the parent's role? But if the parent can't even get access, I didn't expect to hear that as an answer, but that is so very, very true.
Unfortunately,
it is very
Let's
true.
Move to elementary school. That's, again, first grade through sixth grade, or whatever, we may have the middle schools we could do separately, but how about those elementary years? What do parents expect and what's their role in it?
What I'm hearing, what parents are expecting is a small classroom. Now, since there's no money in the school districts, they're losing teacher jobs, and so the classroom sizes are increasing to over 30 kids per class.
Are you kidding?
No, I'm not kidding.
Over 30 kids in an elementary school class.
I'm not kidding.
Not so much in my community, but again, it's really contractual, and it depends on where your child happens to go to school. I think in my community, if I can speak for some of the communities in Rhode Island, what elementary parents want is they really truly want a partnership with the teachers. They want to know what the standards are. We're all standard-based now. They want to know what the grade span expectations are for each level. And they want to know about curriculum. And they want their teachers to share that information with them. And PTA especially is good at giving you those pointers as a parent of how you should approach your school and your teacher and your principal to try to find that information and glean that out so that you can help your child.
That's excellent.
Kathy's spot on about the parent involvement. It's a huge part of PTA, I am remiss in not mentioning it before.
Well, between the two of you, we're getting all kinds of points of view. This is great. Now let's move to the middle school because, again, they're not high schoolers and they're no longer elementary. So many things are happening to them between the fifth and eighth grade there. What are the parents' expectations at middle school?
Gosh, I'm jumping on the parent involvement. In the middle school in our communities, from what I'm hearing is that parents are not welcome with open arms in the school. And so it's a little bit more difficult to get access to the teachers to find out what's going on in the schools. Would you say that?
I think that's probably true. And some of it's a little bit driven by a couple of things, I think. That's just the time when your child, who you've nurtured in the elementary and worked as a team player with your teacher to nurture that child, all of a sudden the kid's kind of pushing you away a bit. And your child is saying, you know, we really don't want you at the school, mommy, or whatever. But I think PTA basically says, guess what? We don't really care. We don't really care that your child might not want you there. You need to be there. And so oftentimes it's the PTA that actually will bring those parents in and give the parents at least a vehicle to get involved with the school, even if they're kind of not in the classroom. Because obviously on the elementary, a lot of parents or even parent, room parents or whatever. Not typical on the middle school or high school level. So, but at least if you're involved with the PTA, you can find out what's happening, even if your kid doesn't bring home the notice in the backpack anymore like they did as elementary students. Right.
And it gives you access to the administrators.
Exactly.
By running programs, I do a little holiday shop at the middle school. By running the programs, now you have a face-to-face contact with the administration in the school.
So this is almost like subversive. We got to get in there. And I applaud you.
I'm sorry.
It's really true. We don't apologize. So that you're talking to a parent and a radical teacher.
Yeah.
I asked when I went into middle school to teach just for a year, middle school gifted. I said, the first thing I need is a parent group. Oh, we don't have parent groups for special classes. So, I mean, immediately, that elementary school, every day when I was in elementary school, parents were in my room. I couldn't function if you're individualizing without parents. So please don't hold back. Now let's move. We have 1 minute to hit high school. And that's probably where the greatest need is because high-stakes testing, don't pass MCAS, you don't graduate.
Parents expect, and what I'm hearing from my communities, is quality, diverse education so that they can have a decent resume when they apply to college.
And or find work if they don't go to secondary, have secondary education. They want to know what that transition should look like. You know, what is their child going to prove that they are ready? And, you know, in Rhode Island we have PBGRs, which are
they're the
requirement, graduation requirements,
right.
And every community has chosen different things to indicate what the student needs to know.
Rhode Island has been somewhat a little bit to the side of what the rest of the nation has been forced to do. I really applaud Peter McWalters, your superintendent, because they do care about where the child is, not just measuring the school. We have to kind of take a break momentarily, but I just wanted to know, I just learned this, that when they measure the third grade to see, and then they come back and measure, they're not measuring those same children. Their third graders have gone to fourth grade. They're now measuring another group and then saying you've made average yearly progress or not.
Oh, that's true.
Isn't this insane? But anyway, we'll come back. How about talking about homework and grades? You know what I'm talking about, whether you're a teacher, a parent, or a taxpayer. Stay with us. I'll be right back.
If you know a kid with a terminal illness who'd like to take their family on vacation for free, I'll give kids the world. I'll never forget it.
On the front page of almost everywhere, listed what schools have good grades, what schools have bad grades. You know, we're all focusing less and less, it seems to me, on are children motivated and are they curious? You can go on the internet and learn anything you want. We're focusing on grades. So I want to hear from you. How important are grades? And let's take different areas. Let's go to the teachers. How important are grades to teachers? And maybe why do you think so?
I think grades are important to teachers because it's a reflection of their teaching. And unfortunately, in Massachusetts, we're driven by MCAS scores, and so much of the teaching is focused toward the test. The kids actually are coming home now with sample questions so that they can practice them at home, and the teachers are mock grading them. So the grades I see as a reflection. The teachers are stressed because it's bad.
If you agree with that, I'll go on to the administrators.
I agree, and I think I feel that way because teachers were brought up with grades. So that's what they're used to being judged as well by. It's very difficult to change in a culture. And when teacher ed programs don't say anything different as well, then teachers go into classrooms thinking they have to grade students on a 0 to 100.
I wonder if I could just interject on that, though, because I talk with a lot of people. Oh, we're at Bridgewater State College.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The training for teachers has changed tremendously.
I know it has, yeah.
So I don't know. I mean, I'm thinking of myself, and I'm not one of the young teachers, but I don't think my classes were driven by I've got to get these kids to get good grades. But then again, high school may be different.
High school's different.
I wasn't
believe
a high school
that.
Teacher.
I think it's less on the elementary
and middle. Schools,
and middle.
Right.
In fact, I think some schools have gone to not the A, B, C, D, and more 1, 2, 3, 4, or whatever, or check marks,
other
or things like that.
Other ways
of evaluation. But like Michelle says, when you have a state test that students have to pass on the high school level in order to graduate, then teachers are very much committed to the fact that they better, that A, that they're giving a student better represents something. And parents expect that, too.
But the third graders are taking the test.
Exactly. I
mean, so how about, let's go to administrators then.
Right.
Aren't they the ones that really get killed if the grades aren't up? I mean, how important are they to administrators? Am I right?
They're the same. Now it's a bigger reflection. Okay, now if our MCAS scores aren't, because this is really what comes home. These are our last year's MCAS scores.
And MCAS, the show is seen in other places. MCAS is the Massachusetts test, comprehensive
assessment
of something. We don't even know what it is, but we know that it means you graduate or you don't if you don't pass. Many states have state tests with different names for them.
It's the measure of success of this school.
And I think that's probably more important than the actual grade on the report card.
Right.
Report card grades are meaningless if your kids really don't have the content behind it, because grades can be inflated. And an administrator, a principal will be judged. Their building will be judged because those scores come out in the paper.
Yeah.
And parents are demanding that their school is a high-performing school, not a moderate.
And how do you feel about the principal that's working in an inner city, stressed out, falling apart school with no computers, and they're judged the same as an upper middle class or upper class community where they have everything because that's another whole thing that we have to talk about in the future. How important are grades to most parents? We hesitate on that one.
Unfortunately, I think they're very important, and it's very difficult to change a parent's mind. Even when we went from, in the elementary, in where I come from, in Coventry, we went from a grade ABC in the elementary to the standards-based 3-4-2, even on the middle school. People were really concerned, what's the numeric score? Is my child still getting high honors? You know, what is a 3 equal really numerically?
Mm-hmm.
So there is a lot of, and it's because of competition. It's competition. Mm-hmm. They want their kid to make sure they get into the Harvard, the Ivy League school, or one of those very selective, high selective schools. So they really, and it starts in K.
Believe me, when I was teaching first grade, they would say, will my child be ready to go to Harvard in first and second grade in this school? People are but that's right now not the main reflection or the main contemplation for parents right now. About getting into higher education, it's just passing a test.
The test for the high school.
I think you're talking like the high-end kids.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
My concern, mostly because I have one, is the kid in the middle of the road.
Yeah, they fall through the cracks.
They fall through the cracks. So whenever I see the middle or the low grades come home, guess what? I'm like, what isn't the teacher giving? And is it because the class is so big? Is it because it's driven by MCAS? It's stressful as anything.
Yes, I can see that. Now, what about the kids themselves? how important, we better think the younger children and then maybe high school people. Mm. I shouldn't interrupt the time, but an anecdote, when I went in for my master's, I was already teaching and my husband had passed away, and I went back for my master's, and I was so excited because I thought, oh, we can ask high-level questions. But I said, I'm mature, and we're in here with 18-year-olds, so I won't jump right in and raise my hand right away. Well, the professor asked a question, and nobody responded, and he went into a tirade about, if you want to get an A in this class, and you're...
Class participation.
And I did not come there to go get an A. I was coming because I was highly interested in what I was working on at that level, at the master's level, and I got myself in trouble with my response when I did raise my hand, but anyway, the grade, even at college level, to be... try to motivate anybody by a grade?
It's a sad situation.
What about the students?
They're motivated by grades.
They are,
kids
too.
And
the unfortunate thing is the saddest thing in the world is when a child comes into kindergarten, first grade, or whatever, and is so excited about everything. Our little ones are excited about everything. And by the time they go through the system, oftentimes as seniors, they're not anymore.
No.
It's what
the dropout rate is showing quite a bit.
So we have to really look at what are we doing wrong? And part of it is the high stakes testing really has driven us away from what
real
it
learning.
Is. Yeah,
the excitement.
Let's excite these kids. Mm-hmm. Let them problem solve. Let them try to do something different. To prove that they understand. We really want kids to be able to go out there on their own and think on their own. That's really what you want.
You want that, but what happens is not always that way.
No, you crush the spirit.
This is, of course, he's a tremendous radical, Alfie Cohn. He's written 6 or 8 books in several languages. Yeah. What does it mean to be well-educated? Mm. And he deals with all these points about the testing and so forth. And it says here, virtually all specialists condemn the practice of giving standardized tests to children younger than 8 or 9. And he said, virtually all relevant experts and organizations condemn the practice of basing important decisions, such as graduation or promotion, on the result of a single test. And, you know, we went away from that for a while, but now with all this business world running the world, I should not be commentary. I want to go back to you because I could, you know, I sit here and hear from so many people and I get very excited, especially when I'm with other parents. I want to ask you this about homework. That has been on all the front page of where I live. Parents are going in there and protesting. And I won't tell you the anecdote about how I have to work with my little first grader because my daughter-in-law is going out of her mind with this first grade homework. I'd say read a book with them, talk with them about the story. We're pasting and cutting and hanging and doing, and the parent has to do so much. So I'm kind of worried about what's happening with homework. Speech.
I am going to take a middle of the road here.
Yeah, no, that's okay. That's good.
Yes, homework is challenging. Yes, it's taking up time. What I'm hearing from educators and from students and from parents is that, well, it's all different depending on who you talk to. The way I see it is that homework in this day and age is fairly necessary because of the grade driven, because of this testing driven.
Does it make a
that
difference?
That there's not enough time. Does it make a well,
there's
I think
not research in that says if you work on the same thing for 2 hours, there's absolutely no research that proves that that's going to change that child's learning and advance, but they're doing it and they feel comfortable.
I think meaningful homework.
Ah, thank you. Will you say that again?
Meaningful homework.
Does everybody hear that?
Because really, that's what it's all about. If kids get a paper that they're just drilling, oftentimes that's the boring piece. Even as high schoolers, as they go all the way through,
if it's just
Busy work.
We all know that word, don't we?
Then they resent it. And oftentimes they just refuse to do it. And my tact when I brought my child up was if my child came home with a homework assignment that she could not do, I didn't help her. I would write across the paper. And I tell my parents all the time, my child doesn't know how to do this. You need to go over this and or tell me what to do to make this better. Yeah. And that stopped all the tears. Because that's what parents have. They have the tears with their kids going, you don't know how to do it right, and then I'm here too long. And I think the other piece that a lot of teachers forget is that some students will take the same homework assignment and take 2 hours to do it. One will do it in a half hour or 15 minutes.
Right.
So you have to have differentiated
know
homework.
Your children.
You need differentiate, because homework is important, I think. It teaches some discipline. It teaches that sometimes you have to go home and do something above and beyond what you've done in the classroom. It can be very, very meaningful.
Yes, and I've got one thing. It's our job as parents to advocate for our kids.
Yes.
To get in there, just
and
like
and if you,
you
see your child struggling,
I
and,
don't understand it.
And that's the piece when you, as a parent, you get involved and you say, you ask other parents, how long did your student take to do that homework assignment? Did that seem reasonable? And then that kind of keys you into as whether or not your own child needs some extra something.
I'm hearing very good things from you from the PTA side, because often when I was inside the school, we need to teach our teachers the basics of, if you don't know your student, if you don't know that your student works slowly or needs extra help, and then you don't just hand the same homework out to everybody.
No, you
hear more about that in elementary than in high school, because people say, oh, well, it's not fair. Well, we're not here to be fair. We're here to educate people.
Plus, it's the sink or swim mentality in the high school. So.
I know, and there's a lot to be fixed. There's more to be fixed in the high school.
I
personally don't want the business world to be fixing it with the market movement, but having parents do it, you can do it. Let's quickly, we have only about less than 2 minutes. Attitudes of the students and models for kids often come from the popular culture. And I'm concerned that maybe we're commercializing and over-sexualizing children too young. What are you feeling about the pressure of TV, video games, all the rest of the media?
It's there. There's pressure, and as school funding decreases, there's more and more corporate influence in the schools.
And I think PTA has done a really good job at educating parents. We have many things on our website, you know, what kind of sites, internet sites you should go to find out the ratings for certain programming, what video games may not be the best choice for your child. And I think as a parent, you need to put your foot down.
Internet safety is
and
a
say,
big topic.
Internet safety as well. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Thank you. We have several topics. We can do it at a future date.
Okay.
Thank you so much, Michelle Tremont and Katherine Patenaude, PTA presidents. Thank you so much.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you.
In closing, PTA, like any group, is not monolithic. They don't hold one unswerving view on everything in education. But to me, the excitement and the value of PTA is not only that they do great book sales and bake sales, but beyond that, they provide an opportunity for parents to look at issues and find some very, what will I call it, they can engage in action-producing school talk.
Join the discussion. Send your comments to schooltalk@bridgew.edu.